प्लीज मैम स्टार्ट द सेशन। कंचन मैम।
ओके सर, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन हु ऑल आर प्रेजेंट हियर। इट्स माय प्लेजर टू इंट्रोड्यूस मिसेस गीतांजलि कल्याण। शी इज करंटली वर्किंग एज अ ट्यूटर इन पीजीआई चंडीगढ़, व्हिच इज आल्सो नोन एज नेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ नर्सिंग एजुकेशन। She graduated from the same institute in 2005 and then completed her master's in pediatric nursing from AIIMS, New Delhi. She has total 13 years of experience, teaching experience, and she has 35 publications in different journals. She has authored 18 book chapters and over 46 national and international conferences she has conducted as a speaker. She is also an active member of INN and NNF and TNI and PNNF. She is a zonal coordinator of Indian Association of Neonatal Nurses and executive member of National Neonatology Forum. We welcome you, ma'am. Kindly start your session.
Thank you, Kanchan ma'am, for introducing me. And I also would like to thank Nursing Teacher Association of India for including me in this important webinar series on nursing theories, which is itself indeed a important, thoughtful activity and very useful for nursing fraternity. And I thank the president sir and the association and also Kanchan ma'am for giving me this opportunity. So now we are going to start with very important theory, that is transcultural nursing theory. So this is a theory of middle range, and Madeline Leninger, she is the founder of theory of transcultural nursing. She was an internationally known educator, author, theorist, administrator, researcher, consultant, and public speaker. The theory is also known as cultural care theory. Theoretical framework is depicted in her model called Sunrise Model. So she gave Sunrise Model, and she started working on this theory way back in 1945, and she completed the work by 1950s, and thereafter so many publications she has made on the same work. According to her, the main focus for nursing care is to fit with or have beneficial meaning and health outcomes for people of different or similar cultural backgrounds. So as I said, she has created an enormous amount of literature, and some of the important literature created by her is Cultural Care Diversity and Universality. It was published in 1991, but she developed the theory in 1950s. The theory was further developed in her book Transcultural Nursing in 1995, and then came the third edition on Transcultural Nursing in 2002. The theory-based research and the application of transcultural theory are explained. So Madeline Leninger, she was born in 1925 in Sutton, Nebraska. She completed her schooling and in 1948, and she completed her BSN from Nebraska Creighton University. And in 1954, she completed her master's in mental health nursing from the Catholic University of America in Washington, D.C. She did work as a child psychiatric nursing program as associate professor for 3 years, and then she completed her doctorate in 1966 from the University of Washington, Seattle. And throughout her career from 1954 to 1995, she has worked on different positions, and her career has more work in the Department of Anthropology and in transcultural nursing. And she has worked in different capacities in different institutes of name. And she has different honors in her credit, like she was a fellow of American Academy of Nursing. She distinguished fellow of Royal College of Nursing, Australia. She is living legend by American Academy of Nursing in 1998. Honorary degrees from Bennington College, University, Indianapolis, and University of Kuopio, Finland. So now coming on to the concept of the theory, how it came to her mind and what all things she did and what are the concepts related to the theory. Madeline Leninger, while working as a nurse, she identified that there is a lack of cultural care and knowledge in the component of nursing care. Many variations were required in nursing a patient to support compliance, healing, wellness. So she planned to develop a theory of transcultural nursing, and she completed its work by 1950. Theory attempts to provide culturally congruent nursing care through cognitively based assistive, supportive, facilitative, or enabling acts or decisions that are mostly tailor-made to fit with individual groups or institutions, cultural values, beliefs, and the life phase. Theory involves knowing and understanding different cultures with respect to nursing and health illness caring practices, beliefs, and values, with the goal to provide meaningful and efficacious nursing care services to people according to their culture, values, and health illness context. It focuses on the fact that different cultures have different caring behaviors, different health illness values, beliefs, and patterns of behavior. So her focus is to provide the care that is culturally sensitive. If we will not recognize the people culture, we will not be able to identify their caring behavior, how do they value the illness, and what are their measures do they take during the illness, what are their behavior during the illness. It is very important to know this. Definition of transcultural nursing. It is a substantive area of study and practice focused on comparative cultural care or caring values, beliefs, and practices of individuals or groups of similar or different cultures, with the goal of providing culture-specific universal nursing care practices in promoting health or well-being, or to help people to face unfavorable human conditions, illnesses, or death in culturally meaningful ways. So this is the definition which was given by her about transcultural nursing. Use of empiric evidence. Leninger favors ethno methods as the desired and meaningful approach to study the care, because these methods are directed toward discovering the people's truth, views, belief, and patterned life ways. So ethnographic methods were adopted by her to study the cultural behavior of people. There were certain major concepts and definitions. There are n number of different definitions and different major concepts and sub-concepts which we are going to discuss in next couple of slides, and then we will talk about the sunrise model. So culture. So first concept is culture. It is a set of values, beliefs, and traditions that are held by a specific group of people and handed down from generation to generation. It also includes belief, habit, likes, dislikes, customs, rituals, learns from one's family. The learned, shared, and transmitted values, beliefs, norms, and life way practices of a particular group that guide thinking decisions and actions in a patterned way. Culture is learned by each generation through both formal and informal life experiences. Language is the primary through means of transmitting the culture. So any child learns these things from the family through formal or informal ways, not only from families, but what the child observes in the community where the same culture is being observed. So through language, they learn different things. They are transmitted from person to person, and also through observations, they learn these things. The practices of particular culture often arise because of the groups of social and physical environment. So these practices, they depend what are they facing in their current scenarios, and different practices, they emerge and they are being adopted by a different culture. Cultural practices and beliefs are adapted over time, but they mainly remain constant as long as they satisfy the needs. Now coming on to the next major concept, that is religion. Is a set of belief in a divine or superhuman power to be obeyed or worshipped as the creator and ruler of the universe. Next is ethnic. It refers to a group of people who share a common and distinctive culture and who are members of specific group. Ethnicity, a consciousness of belonging to a group. Then coming on to the cultural identity, the sense of being part of an ethnic group or a culture. Then coming on to the cultural universals, these are the commonalities of values, norms of behavior, or life patterns that are similar among different cultures. Then culture specifics, values, beliefs, and patterns of behavior then tend to be unique to a designated culture. So there are certain things which are unique to a particular culture, and they are being followed by the people who experience those things over the period of time, and they are being adopted by the culture. Then coming on to the material culture, it refers to objects, dress, art, religious artifacts. So different cultures have their different type or ways of dressing. Some people, they cover the whole body. Some, they believe in modern dressing. And some different cultures have different type of material culture. A non-material culture, it refers to beliefs, customs, languages, and social institutions. So every culture has different beliefs. They follow different particular rituals. They have their own languages, and they go to a specific social institutions. They have their own ways of representing their customs and traditions. So this is known as non-material culture. Then coming on to the subculture, it is composed of people who have distinct identity but are related to a larger group of culture. Biculture, a person who crosses two cultures, lifestyles, and set of values. Say, for example, a person migrates from one part of the country to the other part of the countries and and learns about the different cultures. Sometimes these bicultural things is being followed by the Indian Indian females after their marriage. So they have to adopt or do different cultures if they get married into a different place. Diversity refers to the fact or the state of being different. Diversity can occur between cultures and within a cultural group. Acculturation, people of a minority group tend to assume the attitudes, values, beliefs, mind, practices of the dormant society, resulting in blended cultural patterns. So this is known as acculturation, that is being followed by the group of minority. Then coming on to the cultural shock. So as we said, one person may experience two different cultures. So one, when the person is living from his birth till his adulthood in the same culture, and then he migrate from one culture to another, that creates a cultural shock. That is a state of being disoriented or unable to respond to a different cultural environment because of its sudden strangeness, unfamiliarities, incompatibility to the stranger perceptions and expectations, as it is differentiated from others by symbolic markers. They have everything different: culture, biology, territory, religion. So a person experiences a kind of shock, a disorientation, because he has migrated from one culture to the other. Coming on to the ethnic group, it shares common social and cultural heritage that is passed on to successive generations. So this is known as ethnic group. It is being transmitted to the generations. It is passed to the generations. Then coming on to the ethnic identity, it refers to subjective perspective of person's heritage and to a sense of belonging to a group that is distinguishable from the other groups. Then coming on to the race, the classification of people according to the shared biological characteristics, genetic markers, or features. Not all people of same race have the same culture. Then cultural awareness. It is an in-depth self-examination of one's own background, recognizing biases and prejudices and assumptions about other people. So once we become aware about self and the others, that called cultural awareness, that how the things are being done in particular to our culture and how the things are being done to the other culture. Like it, when we go to a wedding of a friend who belong to some other culture. So we tend to find out different culture, different ways of getting married, and the different practices being followed after the marriage. So this is known as cultural awareness. Recognize the different biases and prejudices and assumptions about the people. Then coming on to the culturally congruent care. Care that fits the people's valued life pattern and set of meanings, which is generated from the people themselves rather than based on predetermined criteria. So this is always passed from generation to generations. So this is a kind of fixed pattern that values that are generated by the people, and they are based on always on a predetermined criteria. They cannot be immediately changed. It takes time for people to change or to adopt a different culture or different practices. This is known as culturally congruent care. So that care that fits within their culture, it is culture specific. Say for example, if in some cultures, while providing care, people feel that they should not be asked about how is their relationship with the spouse. And in some time, some relations, people they do not like if they are being seen. They do not have eye contact while they are interacting with each other. They find it offending. So different cultures have different practices. Some people they have a practice that they will not express their pain, even if it is. If the pain is there, they will not express the pain. So these cultures, as nurses, we have to identify what the particular culture is being followed at different place, and we have to provide culturally congruent care to the people of that particular society. And even when we are taking the history, we have to take care of the culture of people. How do they respond? What questions we need to ask? Sometimes people do not openly, in some of the cultures, people do not openly talk about their relationship with the spouse, the problems they face. So they have to be interviewed while taking history in a different manners. Different cultural specific questions are to be asked from people. Otherwise, they feel offended. They feel that the person is trying to be more intimidated. So we have to provide culturally congruent care. Then come culturally competent care. This word comes from the cultural congruent care, the ability of practitioners to bridge cultural gap in caring work with cultural differences and enable client and families to achieve meaningful supportive care. So when we provide culture specific care in our day-to-day routine, it is known as cultural competent care. Now coming on to the subcom concepts. There are different sub concepts in the theory. First one is generic folk or lay care system. So this generic folk or lay care system are culturally learned and transmitted indigenous or traditional or folk home-based knowledge and skill used to provide assistive, supportive, enabling or facilitative acts towards or for another individual, group or institution with evident or anticipated needs to ameliorate or improve human life way, health condition, or to deal with the handicaps and the health situations. So what are the traditions, what are the home-based folks that are being followed? They are being used to render the care. We need to identify those practices, those traditions. These care systems are always learned from the culture. And then we have to adapt these cultural folk ways into the care systems. Then comes the another sub-concept, that is emic. Emic refers to knowledge gained from direct experiences or directly from those who have experienced it. So we learn from the experiences of people, and then we identify that what is being observed, what is being followed. It is generic or folk knowledge. So from their experiences, we gain it and we try to implement it. Then coming on to the professional care system. So professional care system are defined as formally taught, learned and transmitted professional care, health, illness, wellness, and related knowledge and practice skills that prevail in professional institutions, usually with multidisciplinary personnel to serve the consumer. So this is very, very important from the professional point of view, from professional institution view, that if we are providing multidisciplinary services, we should know that how the system is being defined, what is being taught formally, and how it is being learned, and how it is transmitted in the professional care, and what is the health, illness, wellness and related knowledge is being utilized by the professional institutions. So it is always decided that if we are providing services in a particular part of the country where different culture is being used and how to interact with the people, and we should be knowing their cultural habit, are they vegetarian or non-vegetarian. Some of the culture people, they do not even like talking about non-vegetarian things, and we have to be very 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 sensitive while dealing with the patients. Some of the patients, they even don't like taking food if someone else is eating non-veg in their premises. So we have to identify, and sometimes we have to rearrange the beds or the units according to the culture specific needs of the individual. And that things have to be defined by the institutions, identified, because that we are providing services in that particular region of the country. And if someone from different cultures get admitted, then we have to identify their needs, their values, and how do they perceive illness, and how do they provide, what are their behaviors about the particular disease, and their culture specific eating habits. These things are very, very important. Even while taking the history, we get to know many things about, and you get to know about the culture or about the religion of a particular individual. So that give you idea about different practices that might have been followed in a particular culture, right? So it is very, very important to have professional care systems that is well defined and transmitted from in a kind of a professional care, health, illness, wellness related knowledge practice scheme. Then coming on to the ethic, knowledge which describes the professional perspective. It is professional care knowledge. So the knowledge which is professionally being utilized is known as ethic. Then coming on to the ethnohistory. Ethnohistory include those parts, facts, events, instances, experiences of individuals, groups, cultures, and instructions that are primarily people-centered, and which describe, explain, and interpret human life ways within particular cultural context and over short or long period of time. So it is very, very important to, as we also learned that Leninger also used ethnography as one of the major components of her studies while she discovered the transcultural nursing. So it is important to find out the past facts or events or the experiences that a group of individual had before we include them into the culture context. Then coming on to the care. According to the Leninger theory, care is defined in two ways. One as a noun and another one as a verb. There is a slight difference between the two. Care as a noun is defined as those abstract or concrete phenomena related to assisting, supporting, or enabling experiences or behaviors towards or others with evident or anticipated needs to ameliorate or improve human conditions or life ways. So these are the abstracts of concrete phenomena. Whereas if you talk about care in terms of words, it is defined as the concrete actions, the activities that are directed towards assisting, supporting, and enabling other individuals or groups with evident or anticipated needs to ameliorate or improve human condition or life way or to face the death. So this is the difference between noun and the verb care. Coming on to the cultural imposition. Cultural imposition refers to efforts of the outsider, both subtle or not so subtle, to improve his or her own cultural values, beliefs, behaviors upon an individual, family, or group from other culture. So sometimes we have to adopt the good things from the other cultures. If there are certain cultural impositions which are not healthy, or they are not being considered good, so we have to make some efforts to adopt some things from the another culture. So this is known as cultural imposition. Now, coming on to the major assumptions of the theory, illness and wellness are shaped by various factors, including perception and coping skills, as well as the social level of the patient. The cultural competence is an important component of nursing. Culture influences all spheres of human life. It defines health, illness, and the search for relief from disease and distress. So every culture strives that how are they going to have relief from the illness? How are they going to manage the pain? How are they going to manage the illness? What are things that are being done culture specific to deal with the illness and the disease? Religious and cultural knowledge is an important ingredient of healthcare. So spirituality is also important when we are dealing with the disease and illness. The use of traditional or alternate models of healthcare delivery is widely varied and may come into conflict with Western model of healthcare practices. So we have to consider the culture, the traditions, but in any case, if any of the practices in the culture is not healthy and we want to discourage that particular practice, if in some of the cultures or religions that the practices which are not useful, for example, in some of the culture and traditions, they have a belief that we will not have any immunization for our child. It's the God's will. They will survive on their own, right? So we have to encourage them to change their view, right? So use of traditional or alternate model of healthcare delivery widely varies. And sometimes with the modern healthcare, it has number of conflicts that this is our particular tradition, or this is a particular thing we are following from the years and years, and how come it can be incorrect or it can be unhealthy? We have been doing the same thing from years, like circumcision is being given. So sometimes the newborn will have an infection related to it, but still they have a belief that it is to be done, and it was done in years and years in our culture. So we have to teach them that how to prevent the infection. In any case, it is very important to do. So cultural competent care is very, very important. Sometimes it may have to face conflict with the modern care. So we need to learn the ways to deal with those conflicts. Then cultural guides behavior into acceptable ways for people in specific groups. As such, culture originates and develops within the social structure through interpersonal interactions. So these interactions are important because these interactions develop the cultural practices over the period of time. So there are different acceptable ways of behavior for people in a particular group. And these behavior, they develop through the interactions only. So girls in a particular culture are supposed to be, they are supposed to follow particular rituals. They are supposed to sit like this, not like that. You know, they are supposed to dress in a particular way. So even for the boys also, how they are supposed to be more dominating. You know, they should control their wife. So different cultures have different ways, and these things the child learn through observations, through interaction with the people. The way the family behaves in a particular manner, the child is going to learn the same, and as an adult, he is going to adopt the same. So those interactions, those observations are leading to the behaviors that are adopted by the individual. For a nurse to successfully provide care to a client of a different culture or ethnic background, effective intercultural communication must make place. So it is important. It is important to know the culture, and we should interact with the people of different culture in a different way. And we have to be culturally sensitive as nurses while we are rendering the care. So there are certain health practices in different cultures, like there are gender roles. As I was saying, in many of the Indian setups, the gender roles are different. So the men are supposed to do this, but the women is not supposed to do this. Men can go out of the house. They have more freedom to do the things whereas the women are supposed to stay at home. And even the women who are uneducated, who are illiterate, living in the villages, they do not even have more access to health. They cannot talk about, they cannot choose the their own practices, their own, they cannot choose the things. Even if we are talking about the sexual relationship, the use of the protective devices, they do not have a say that they want to use this or that. So the gender roles are different in different cultures. Beliefs about mental health. So people have different beliefs. Some people and some of the culture, if anybody is having mental illness, it is considered as bad sign. People, they do not have interaction with the people who are having mental illness. There are many myths associated with mental illness. People feel that it cannot be cured. So there are different beliefs about mental illness. Then religious practices are different, that some are only choose vegan diet, some choose vegetarian, some choose non-vegetarian. In some of the religions, women are supposed to cover their face. They cannot go out of the house without covering their face. So there are different religious practices that are being followed. Then traditional remedies. There are some traditional remedies are being used that to cure a particular disease. There are different traditional remedies. They are being used like in a Hindu culture. Some of the temples, they have different remedies for the remedies, like they will use Ganga Jal to treat the herpes. They will apply the Ganga Jal over the herpes simplex, and they would call the person to apply that Ganga Jal with a specific instrument over that particular area, and with the help of prayers, they will try to they will say that it will heal. So they will use the healers accordingly, according to the tradition, the traditional remedies and the healers. Then immigration is another practice of moving from one place to the other and learning about different cultures. Then personal space. People in different cultures have different personal space, and they do not want it to be intruded by even their children or by their spouse. And then use of protective equipments is there. Use of substances, economic factors, and time already. These are some of the cultural practices that are being used by the different cultures. So this was about the important terminology that Leninger uses in the culture transcultural model, and her theory is basically related with the culture. She also gave up this model that symbolizes rising the sun, the square model. The upper half, this is the, let me show you the model first. So this model has a half circle, that upper half of the circle is gray colored, and the middle half is light yellow in color, and there is the inner circle, and that these things are related with the subsystems. And these subsystems, according to this all culture, the nursing care decisions and actions are being taken by the three important decisions. These are the nursing decisions. So the upper half of the circle depicts the components of the social structure and the worldview factors that influence care and health through language and environment. These factors influence the folk, professional, and nursing system, which are in the lower half of the model. So the folk and professional systems, these are in the lower half of the model. The two halves form a full sun, which represents the universe that nurse must consider to appreciate human and healthcare. So two halves make a full sun that the nurse has to consider while she is rendering the care. The nursing subsystem can act as a bridge between the folk and the personal health system through the three types of nursing actions, that is cultural care preservation, cultural care accommodation, and culture repatterning. So these are the nursing actions that are based on these three important systems. So this is the worldview, culture, and social structure dimensions, the outer half of the moon. And the inner half of the moon includes the includes the technological factors, religious and philosophical factors, kinship, kinship and the social factors, cultural values and beliefs, political and legal factors, economical factors, educational factors. So these all factors are going to affect the worldview, how an individual is going to see the world. What I have been through from my birth till date, I'm going to view the world through that way, right? If I am being taught that the women can be working, they can go out of the home, they have the right to choose their decision, they have the right to choose things, they can make their own decisions, they can work independently, they have a right to choose over their dressing sense. So the woman of a particular culture is going to view the world in the same manner. And she will be surprised to see a woman who is living in the houses. They are not allowed to go out of the home. They cannot choose about their health. They cannot work. So this thing is going to affect them, giving them cultural shock, as I was discussing earlier, that Leninger has defined the term cultural shock. So what I've been taught from birth till date, I'm going to see the world with that perspective. So then comes the other influences like care expressions, patterns and practices, holistic health and death. So these all things which are in the center are going to affect our health practices, our view towards the health, death, illness and everything, right? So if you have different perceptions about a particular thing, definitely you are not going to seek the health services. If in some of the culture, if the disease and illness is there, yeah, people believe that this is being given by God. So they may not seek health services for that particular illness or that particular problem, right? Sometimes women, even if experiencing problem in the some of the Indian cultures, they are not made outspoken. They cannot talk about their problem. They cannot go to the health personnel on their own. They have to tell the things to their husband. And if they are willing and they are considerate, they will take them to the health practitioner. Otherwise, they have to remain silent. They cannot choose about their health services. Then individual families, groups, communities, or institution in diverse health contexts. So now all these things, all these factors are related with these subsystems. What were these subsystems? That is generic or the folk care, nursing care, and professional system. So nursing care has to make a balance between the generic and folk care. That is the experiences of the individual or what is being practiced in a particular culture, and the professional systems, that how the professional system is working considering the culture. So nursing care has to balance between the two, and it is also being influenced by the individuals, all the factors the individual is viewing the world with, the nursing care will be affected. And nurse has to find out that how she has to provide cultural sensitive care, and if some of the practices are not healthy that are being followed by a culture, how to change those practices. This is very, very important. And a nurse makes the decision by three actions: culture, care, preservation, and maintenance. If it is good, it is promoting the health, it is not causing any harm, preserve it and maintain it. Cultural care, accommodate, and negotiation. Accommodate a new thing if it is required, and negotiation, that this thing is not, cannot be done and we need to negotiate about it. And a cultural care repatterning and structuring. So now we have to entirely restructure this thing. We should not be doing this thing because this is not healthy. And how to change those things are important. And the nurse has to think or to take decision on based on these three major dimensions. So as we were discussing the generic and folk care. So this generic and folk care, the system and professional system, both systems in which the nurse has to balance in between, the nursing care has to balance between these two, generic care and the professional system. These healthcare, that generic folk system versus professional system, is affected by a number of factors like technology, religion, kinship, values and worldview and assumptions. What are the assumptions of an individual? Politics and law, economics and education. These all factors are affecting the generic and the professional subsystems. So the decisions, as we discussed, these are the three major systems through which the nurse take the decision. Rather, we should say these are the action modes: the culture preservation and maintenance, culture care accommodation and negotiation, culture care repatterning or restructuring. So let us look at them one by one. First one is culture preservation and maintenance. It is also known as maintenance. It includes those assistive, supportive, facilitative or enabling professional actions or decisions that help people or a particular culture to retain or preserve relevant care values so that they can maintain their well-being, recover from illness or face handicaps or deaths. So these were good, they were not harming, these were practices. These practices, they can be followed. So there is no problem in following, they can be retained and let them retain it, let them do it the way they want to. Then cultural care accommodation or negotiation, it is also known as negotiation, includes those assistive, supportive, facilitative, enabling, creative, professional actions and decisions that help people of a designated culture to adapt to or negotiate with others for a beneficial or satisfying health outcome with professional care providers. So they have to balance, they have to negotiate that, no, this is, maybe this can be a little modified this way, or maybe we need to accommodate a new particular thing, and that is important, that will be more beneficial for your health outcome. So this is known as cultural care accommodation or negotiation. Then comes cultural care repatterning or structuring. It includes those assistive, supportive, facilitative or enabling professional actions or decisions that help a client reorder, change or greatly modify their life ways for new different beneficial healthcare patterns. So they have to entirely different. In the previous one, they have to accommodate one or two things. And this is, they have to entirely change. They have to entirely change a particular system that greatly modify their health and beneficial healthcare. They have to adopt a beneficial healthcare pattern while respecting the client's cultural value. So we have to make them understand that, I understand that you were following this from the years and years and nothing happened to your to you or to your ancestors, but recently the healthy conditions have changed. Now people are acquiring new illness. And now all of us, you look at this corona thing. Were we using masks day to day? Were we using hand sanitizers? Were we not eating outside? We were happy eating different things outside home. So we had to change entirely in this corona thing. We are using the mask outside. We are time and again cleaning our hands. We are cleaning our house. We are keeping our shoes outside home. We are washing our keys, car keys when we are coming home. We are taking shower. So entirely we had to change the things, right? So, and this is what it is, repatterning and restructuring. Now coming on to the strengths and weaknesses. Strengths: the sunrise model is developed in a logical order to demonstrate the interrelationship of concepts in her theory of culture, care, diversity and universality. The theory is essentially parasynonymous in that the necessary concepts are incorporated in such a manner that theory and its model can be applied in many different settings. It is highly generalizable. The concept and relationships that are presented are at level of abstraction, which allow them to be applied in many different situations. Though not simple in terms, it can easily understood upon first contact. So it is easily understandable. Though it appears very complex, the theory is very complex. There are a number of terminology, different things are being used, but it is very simple and easy to understand. Weakness: the theory and model are not simple in terms. In these terms, they are number of terms. Though once you read them, they become easy, but they look very complex when you do not make efforts to try to understand them. So application to nursing, it can be used to develop understanding, respect, appreciation for individuality and diversity of patients' beliefs, values, spiritualities, and culture regarding illness, its meaning, cause, treatment, and outcome. To encourage in developing and maintaining a program of physical, emotional, spiritual self-care, introduce therapies such as Ayurveda and Panchkarma. So these things were in our culture from years and years. Ayurveda and Panchkarma and yoga, everything was there in our culture, right? So we have to adopt those things. We are still still following these things. We are still using Ayurveda. We are using Panchkarma as a care. Then into nursing practice, if we talk about how this transcultural nursing can be utilized, communities are becoming more multicultural and health professionals are being expected to respond to the client's diverse cultural needs. So now people have migrated from one place to the others. They have experience of different cultures. So nurses have to see that if person is restricted to a particular culture or person has a wide varied experiences and he can respond to different situation in a different manner. Immigrants and people from unfamiliar culture are generally expecting nurses to respect their culture, values, beliefs and life. So as I said, if they are limited to one particular culture and they are not familiar with what is being followed by the other people, this can be done or this cannot be done, and some things may be very strange to them. So nurses have to really, really understand their culture, and she has to provide very specific care to their culture because they are not going to accept it. They are totally unfamiliar that this can also be done. Right? So if you talk about nursing education, since 1980s, an increasing number of nursing curricula has implemented transcultural nursing and care, and there are number of articles, those who have talked about transcultural nursing and how it is to be utilized. In the research, it can also be used. Many of the nurses in USA and other countries have used this model in their research. Here is just a simple example of a 45 years old man who was of Asian descent, and he has laparotomy 24 hours back. He was asked for his pain, but every time when he was asked for the pain, he responded that he is not having any pain, though his facial expression were indicating something else. So in this culture, not to admit their pain because it was considered as a sign of weakness. Sometimes as in our day-to-day routine, we experience men in our Indian setup, like, or even other culture, men is considered to be more strong. They cannot express their emotions as we women can express. Even if they are feeling like crying, they cannot cry in social. But we women, we may start crying because it is acceptable for us, but not for the men. Like similar in Asian culture, the way people are not supposed to admit if they are they have pain, because it is considered a sign of weakness. A patient takes medication when it is given, but patient himself will not ask for it because it is not being considered as good in the culture. So due to his culture beliefs, he is unable to express his emotions and relating to the level of pain because it is culturally unacceptable. Nurse would use culture accommodation to adjust the patient's plan of care to meet his specific physical needs using visual scale of pain assessment and provide the medications accordingly. So I found one important article where transcultural nursing is different studies about transcultural nursing were studied. And a systematic analysis was done, and it was seen that what are the current trends in theoretical works related to the transcultural nursing. So to explore the current trends, they have used different databases like PubMed, Sinhal and Scopus databases, and they find out number of articles that around 123, and many of them were duplicates or some of the studies were excluded, either they were not full text or some of the studies were excluded because they were not non-English, and there were no guidelines that culturally competent care was provided or not, irrelevant to the theory or concepts or model, and these studies were excluded, and total 68 studies were included in the analysis. And they found that there are different four current trends were observed, like purposes of exploring, defining, clarifying and reflecting. So different concepts were used for this purpose, and various theorizing and methods. The different theories were used to analyze or to find out the data, and multiple sources of theorizing. Different sources were used to theorize a particular new concept. Clear linkages or nursing practice, clear linkages to nursing practice and research. So these were the four current trends identified. For first one example, like purpose of exploring, defining and clarifying and reflecting. the framing sexual, for example, for framing sexual risk behavior model was presented with purpose of exploring the lesser known phenomena of an urban adolescent American Indian young female sexual risk behavior. So, so to frame a sexual risk behavior, with the purpose of exploring lesser known phenomena, transculture nursing model was used because this kind of sexual risk behavior was not known. So to identify it, the transcultural theory was used. Also, the theory of cross-culture endeavor was used in palliative care nursing, and it was developed with purpose of investigating how palliative nurses care for the people from diverse cultural backgrounds. So again, the transcultural theory was used, that how nurses provide care to the people of different culture while they are rendering palliative care. So how, which kind of different methods were used to theory, to make the theory or to analyze a particular system after the interviews, like the box and on concept analysis. These are the different models, Rogers and Neff methods, Morse method, one or two other articles they have used, Bond method, or some of has used inductive thematic analysis. So these different methods of theorizing. So these are the different methods. One has to read about these methods, and then these methods can be used according to the study conducted. So what were the sources used? Some used primary data, some of them used secondary data, some used dictionaries or articles. The majority of work relied on the literature. And some of the studies, they utilized the data from survey or from the interviews. So multiple sources are being used. Now, if you talk about clearly, linkages to nursing practice or research, that was the fourth important area. So in to depict the linkages between the nursing practice and research. So how it was done? It was done either with the actual figures, illustrations of the theory, model or concepts. So with the different arrows, as it was depicted in the model, say they made the figure, and they try to show a relationship between nursing practice and the research. A new theoretical definition of a concept, dimensions of concept or antecedents, attributes, consequences, related concepts of the studied concepts. So these methods were used to show the linkage between the practice and the research. For example, authors provided a list of nursing actions for culturally competent care and a list of suggestions for current limitations and assumptions on acculturation that needs to be addressed before applying concept of nursing practice. So culturally competent actions are to be listed down before we start providing care, and a list of the current limitations and assumptions are to be addressed before applying the concept. So this is the bibliography. Thank you very much. This was all about my session, and now I hand over it to Dr. Kanchan.
Thank you so much, ma'am. We have a few questions. So first is from Arpita Kumari. As a nursing, how to help someone who is in cultural shock? She wants an answer to this question. Okay.
So if someone has migrated from one place, one culture to the other culture, say for example, a girl from the north, she got married to a person in the south. And all the practices, even of making the food, the oil, different oil is being used in the north and different oil is being used in the south. They are using coconut oil. In the north, we are using mustard oil. So we have an entirely different practice. So it is really time-taking process. It won't take place within a month. It may take years and years, maybe 5 years or 6 years or even more to adapt to a particular culture, because we cannot adapt it as quickly. If someone tell me to eat a food which is being prepared by coconut oil, it would be very difficult for me to consume it, right? It would be very difficult for me to adopt those cultures, those things that are being done by them, right? So it takes time. The person has to learn by observation. They have to deal with it. They have to know more about cultures. The person has to sometimes read about the culture, that how to adopt it, and if they are illiterate, they cannot read it, they have to observe, they have to bear with, and over that period of time they would be overcome from the cultural shock. It's not an easy time, easy process, and it won't take place within a month or days. It will take years.
Okay, ma'am, second question from same candidate. If you are asking MSc nursing students to apply any theories in Nanda nursing diagnosis as per the Nanda diagnosis, which all things you are expecting them to write?
Related to the transcultural theory.
She has not mentioned. So I think in general you can answer this.
Say for example, since I am from pediatric background, so I would give example of pediatric background. So say for example, if you are using transcultural nursing theory while rendering the care to the patients, so you can use different Nanda nursing diagnosis. Like you can say for
it's
example, say for example, you found that some of the mothers are not giving breastfeed to the baby because in their culture it is being believed that the first feed is to be given by her when her bua will come, only then they will give the first feed to the child. So this is a cultural practice, which is a very harmful practice, right? So you can make another nursing diagnosis on it, right? You can use appropriate Nanda nursing terminology and make a nursing diagnosis for example, if you want to make a nursing diagnosis on this, you can write delay in breastfeeding the child related to the cultural belief, you know, cultural belief of a particular religion or society, जो भी आपका उसमें है, so you can write in that way. So you have to use Nanda nursing diagnosis this way. Sometimes if you are rendering a care to the child who had circumcision and post circumcision had infection, right? So you can use the Nanda nursing diagnosis infection related to the cultural practices of giving circumcision using a unclean blade. So likewise, you can use these Nanda nursing diagnosis rendering the culture specific care, right? And there are some practices which can be slightly modified. Like if we talk about circumcision, you can teach them, if it is very mandatory, they can use a new fresh blade so that the risk of infection can be minimized, right? So this is how culture specific, this is called the nursing decision based on accommodation. As I said, accommodation means slightly modifying. Use a clean, sterile, new blade for a circumcision, right? The first one which I gave example, the breastfeeding will only be given, first feed will only be given when the bua will come, right? So if she is living a far-flung area, she will take 1 week. So they will not give breastfeed for 1 week. That's a harmful thing. That need to be changed. We need to educate them. We need to teach them the importance of first feed, right? So this is how we utilize this transcultural nursing theory in our day-to-day nursing practice. And we can make Nanda nursing diagnosis also.
Thank you, ma'am. I hope Arpita ma'am has got relevant answers to their questions, and she should not have another query about these two questions because ma'am, you have explained very well to them. We have one more question, and she has written thank you also, ma'am, for you for clarifying the doubts. Which kind of studies results can we take specifically to conduct this kind of research for analysis?
Are you asking that can we use, in which studies we can use this Leninger model, transcultural nursing model, or for analysis? I'm not clear. For which analysis?
They have written the kind of research for analysis and which method and theory will be best for this, and what kind of sampling is used. She, I think the person has not mentioned any type of studies, in generally they want to ask. If you are listening, specify your question so that ma'am can clarify your doubt. Which kind of research you want to do, you can write here. I'll ask her to clarify.
Okay, I give an example of my own. Say for example, some of these students is conducting a research on the delay in providing first feed, or they are conducting a research on sexual behaviors. If you are studying these kind of studies, you can use this theory, Lillinger's model, where you have to explore more about the cultural practices, the beliefs and behavior of the individual. Why the feed is being delayed, or why this risky sexual behavior being adopted. So that to study these particular things, such kind of models can be used.
Ma'am, they have mentioned about the meta-analysis, which you have put an example during your session.
Okay.
Meta-analysis.
Yeah. Okay, I'm just quoting this study. You look at the slide, the last reference, caste, culture, nursing, current trends in theoretical work. You download this and see that a number of studies have been used to analyze that how the transcultural nursing explore the thing, what type of theories were used to analyze the data. You know, different studies are being used to conduct the meta-analysis. From those different studies, they took out the major things, like what, say for example, if I had conducted a study on this breastfeeding thing I was telling you, delaying breastfeeding, and I utilized some of the model or some of the theory to analyze it. So they just, through number of studies, they tried to find out that how the what kind of analysis was done and how it was done and what method was used to analyze that thing. So this is how they conducted this meta-analysis, and they tried to find out what current trends are being used by the nursing researchers while they use Madeleine Lellinger theory or any other theory which is related to the culture, and how they analyze it, how they explored it, what method of data collection they used, and based on that, they conducted that analysis.
I hope, Sonia, you have got your answer to the particular question. Ma'am, we don't have other queries. This is all about the question answer session. I would like to say thank you to Gitanjali ma'am for emphasizing especially on this mid-range theory, which is based on the cultural part. And you have well explained about the sunrise model and also emphasized on the cultural importance, which is very, very important. I think being a nurse, when we are working in the hospital, especially in bedside, we face all these things. Like breastfeeding example you have given, I'm also OBG nurse. So we daily basis, yes ma'am, yes please.
There are many other examples. When I was student, I remember there was one resident who, he was from South.
Okay.
So he was from South, and he was taking history from a Punjabi person from North. So he had a lot of difficulty interacting with when he was asking questions. The old man from Punjab, he was giving the history that I belong to pinned this. Mm-hmm. So every time he used to ask different patients, each one of them used to tell that I belong to pinned this and this. Mm-hmm. Right? So he was very curious to know. He called one of the nursing officer and he said that I found that many people are getting sick from the place pinned. So sister explained him that pinned is referred to the word pertaining to a pertaining to village. So they are telling you the village this or that. So different village, they were using the word pind to refer their village, and then they were telling the name of the village. So it was like that.
Yes, ma'am. We also face these kind of problems. I am also trained from Punjab, so we have our classmates from South. So it was very difficult. I can imagine what he was going through at that time. Thank you so much, ma'am. And I think this is beneficial for all the nurses, especially who are working bedside. They can, I think, help the patients how to deal with all these things which is related to the different cultures. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Have a good day.
Thank you so much.
Sir, are you there?
Hello, ma'am. Sorry, sir is not there actually.
Okay.
I'm here. Thank you very much, Geetanjali ma'am and Kanchan ma'am. It was a wonderful session. And I must say, we didn't face any kind of network issues and all.
Yes.
So it went very smoothly. Yes. And madam has edified the knowledge regarding the transcultural theory. And I hope everyone has gained a lot through this, and they can apply in their educational nursing field as well in the clinical practices also, they can apply the theory. Thank you very much for the session. Dear all participants, thank you for your cooperation as well. Tomorrow we are having two sessions from theories and one session from breastfeeding seminar, actually. So it's a hectic Sunday for all of us. So all the best, see you tomorrow. From morning to evening, we are filled with the three sessions. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, ma'am, once again. My heartfelt gratitude towards you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
It's a pleasure for me to be a part of such an important, thoughtful, and useful webinar series. Thank you so much for including me.
Always welcome, ma'am.